The Bite of the Mango, Chapter 11. Ibrahim, Muhammad, and Adamzi were very nice to me when I returned to the camp, taking turns holding the baby and asking me what childbirth was like. "I was asleep for it all," was my answer. Everyone gave me extra food, particularly vegetables. Over dinner, I'd lose myself listening to my cousins talk about their day, kids they'd met on the street while begging, or something funny that happened, like someone getting beaten up for stealing a pineapple from one of the vendors. Then Abdul would start whimpering. My cousins would go elsewhere as Marine Abibatu passed the baby to me. The shadows cast by the fire couldn't conceal the frustration that showed on my face. Begging was completely off limits for me. Even though I desperately wanted to go, I tried everything to get Marie to give me permission. "We need more food because you're giving me so much extra," I'd plead. "No." Muhammad made me feel worse by poking fun at my situation. "You're a grown woman now, Mariatu," he'd laughed. "Why would you want to hang out with us young kids? Stay home with the adults, feed your baby, and we'll look after you." The longing to join my cousins became so strong that one morning after I finished breastfeeding Abdul, I handed him back to Fatmata, stood up, and declared, "I'm going with the others tomorrow." "You can't," Marie protested. "Abdul needs you." Abibatu stepped in. "I'm worried. You and Abdul aren't bonding like a mother and child should. He spends most of his time with us," she said, pointing to herself, Marie, and Fatmata. I will go with Mariatu," I said, a voice from the entranceway to our tent. Startled, we all turned to look. Standing there, her hands on her big hips, was Mabinti. Mabinti was an older lady who lived in one of the other rooms. She hadn't been injured in the war, but rebels had burned her home. She'd walk to Freetown along with the many others from her village. She missed her daughter, who lived in her husband's village in the north of Sierra Leone. "If I could go to the village with her, without fear that the rebels might ambush me," Mabeni would moan, "I'd go tomorrow." The rebels were still invading villages, though not as often as they had in the past. The number of casualties reaching Freetown was diminishing. Still, ECOMOG forces warned Sierra Leoneans to not travel on the main roads or through the western regions of the country in case of sudden attacks. Mabinti didn't have much to do at the camp, so she occasionally helped care for Abdul by bathing him in one of the big plastic tubs or rocking him to sleep as she sang Temne songs. "I will go with Mariatu," Mabinti said again. "I'll look after Abdul while she joins her friends. In my village, I cooked, sewed, and helped look after lots of babies. I was a grandmother to many children. Now I do nothing but sit around and watch the younger women cook." I ran up to Mabinti and hugged her. "Thank you, thank you," I said over and over again. Marie, Fatmata, and Abibatu threw up their arms at the same time. "What are we going to do with you, Mariatu?" Marie exclaimed. The next day, my begging routine started again. Adamzi would wake me in the morning. If Abdul was still sleeping, I'd rush outside and brush my teeth before waking him. After I'd fed him, we all left to camp together. Adamzi, Ibrahim, Muhammad, Mabinti, Abdul, and me. Adamzi and I often slipped off from the boys as people in Freetown gave more money to girls. We'd ask people for Leones all the way to the clock tower in the middle of Freetown, and then all the way back to the camp. Mabinti holding Abdul remaining close. When he was hungry, the three of us would go behind the market stall or down an alleyway, away from the other kids. I'd sit on the dirty ground and breastfeed. Mabinti stood in front of me, blocking any onlooker's view. I gave Abdul back to Mabinti for another hour or so for begging before he indicated he needed me again by puckering his lips and softly crying. Such were my days for a while. One afternoon, quite by chance, I was holding Abdul while Mabinti was off talking to another older woman. I was standing impatiently pacing back and forth when a woman dropped 40,000 leones. about $12 into my black plastic shopping bag. It was the most money that I'd ever earned at one time. Poor child, he said to me. He patted Abdul on the head before walking on. You took pity on you, Mabinti said after I explained excitedly what had happened. Why? I wondered. Because you have not your only yourself to feed, but Abdul, she said. Watch. You start carrying that child and you'll get more money than anybody. Indeed, passerbyers always singled me out when I held Abdul. From then on, I earned more money each day than all of my cousins combined. When Abdul was several months old, a camp official came to our tent one night looking for me. He explained to me in Creole, which I now understood from hearing it all the time in Freetown, that some foreign journalists were coming to the camp the next day. They wanted to interview and take pictures of amputees from the war. Would I come the next morning with Abdul to the main part of the camp to meet them? I was puzzled. What is a journalist? I asked. Someone who will tell your story to people in other countries, the man replied. What did these people want with Mariatu? Marie asked him. She's just a poor village girl. Not anymore, the official said. Her village was ruined and the rebels hurt her badly. The war needs to know about the war in Sierra Leone. Abibatu pressed him further. What will Mariatu get out of this? Maybe someone will read about her and send her money. Try to help her, the man replied. Apparently several youth in the camp have people from foreign countries sending them money and supplies. Some of the children are even going to live in the West, in wealthy countries where there are no wars, all because journalists are telling the world about our problems. At first I said no, thinking of all the money I'd be missing by not begging, but Marie and Fatmata encouraged me to go. Someone might hear about you, Mariatu, and give you money, Fatmata said. The next morning I marched to the center of the camp with Abdul in my arms, a little angry at letting my cousins go off to Freetown without me. I sat down with a huff on a bench, well back from where I could see the camp official and the journalist talking. When the official spotted me, he jogged over, smiling. He led me to a big table where four people were seated. For a moment, I was speechless. For the first time in my life, I was looking at blue eyes and green eyes, yellow hair and brown hair, and these men and women had the lightest skin I had ever seen. A woman with short red hair put her hand on my shoulder. Hello, she said in Creole. That impressed me, since Marie and Ali had told me that the foreigner people didn't speak Temne, Creole, or Mende, and three main languages of Sierra Leone. The woman was pretty, and she made me feel at ease. Can you tell me about what happened to you? The camp representative jumped right in. I didn't know where to begin, so I sat quietly thinking. The lady with the red hair said something to the representative, who turned to me. She wants to know if you are with your family. Yes, I replied. There was an easy question. The representative translated another question from the woman. Do you need anything? Vegetables, clean water, soap, new clothes, dishes. I don't know where my answer came from, but I found myself reciting a long list of everything we didn't have at the camp, but we'd had back at Megbaru. I then broke into my story, or at least a small portion of it. My name is Mariatu. I'm a victim of the rebel attack on Manarma. Child soldiers held me hostage for 10 hours, and they cut off my hands. I now live in Aberdeen with my cousins, Adamzi, Ibrahim, and Muhammad, who were also in the Manarma attack. They don't have hands either. How old is your baby? The red-haired woman asked. His name is Abdul, I replied. He's 5 months old. My first interview with the media lasted about 15 minutes. The representative then led the journalist on a tour of the camp, asking me to follow behind. At one point, he directed me to stand still. Then with Abdul in my arms, so that the photographers could take a picture of me. I remember it well. My bare feet were caked in mud. A dog barked wildly in the background. Behind me was a clothesline. The camp official slipped a few leones in my arms and said he would call for me again. It would be many years before I read the articles written about me that day and in the days to come. Every one of them would come back to haunt me. The journalists all said the rebels had raped me and that I had conceived Abdul during the attack on Manarmo.